So I'll go ahead and get started. Again, a big welcome to everyone who's joined or is currently in the process of joining. This is Data Reporting for Mobile Crisis Services. My name is Avery Bellew. My pronouns are she and her, and we're really glad to have you with us today for this conversation. We're going to jump off our conversation by a couple introductory slides, ones you may have seen before if you've joined this presentation or similar ones in the past. First, a disclaimer that this presentation was prepared for the Medi-Cal Mobile Crisis Training and Technical Assistance Center, M-TAC, which is a partnership between DHCS and it's administered by CARS. This presentation is currently being recorded. We'll say more about that in just a moment, and it will be posted to the website afterwards, so you can view this training at a later date. So a few words about this presentation within the context of mobile crisis. So my mobile crisis services provide rapid response, individual assessment, and community-based stabilization to Medi-Cal members who are experiencing a behavioral health crisis. Mobile crisis services are designed to provide relief to members experiencing a behavioral health crisis, including through de-escalation and stabilization techniques to reduce the immediate risk of danger and subsequent harm, and avoid unnecessary emergency department care, psychiatric inpatient hospitalizations, and law enforcement involvement. So that's why we're here. This conversation around data collection is within the broad construct of what we're trying to accomplish as it relates to mobile crisis services. And this is where we're trying to head with this mobile crisis services benefit. We're trying to change mobile crisis services so that the response is more resolution focused. It provides relief to people in crisis in the community, and it supports people in crisis where they are using the least restrictive means necessary. That's our overarching direction of where we're trying to head together. And a few other things to keep in mind about what mobile crisis services should be. They should be person-centered, trauma-informed, equity-driven. It should be a brief intervention that includes de-escalation and resolution. It's working from a lens, as we've said before, of the least restrictive interventions, and it should be culturally responsive. So this is our framing for our conversation today. If you've joined prior conversations, you've heard these same thoughts before, but it's good to have this in mind as we head into a conversation around data collection. We'll be thinking about multiple parts of these goals, including equity, including thinking about diverse populations as we have this conversation together today. Okay, so that's our introduction. Let's get to welcoming and introductions. So again, my name is Avery Bellew. My pronouns are she and her. I'm a principal with Health Management Associates, and I'm delighted to have this conversation with you today. A little bit of my background. I've been working in suicide prevention and crisis intervention for about 15 years, including doing direct crisis service intervention, as well as working with technical assistance through the Suicide Prevention Resource Center and the National Action Alliance for Suicide Prevention. So I'm really excited to have a conversation about data, about why it's important, about how all of you will be invited to think about data collection and reporting in today's conversation, because it's such an important part of what we do and making sure that we're having a conversation about the work that we're doing. I would love for you all to introduce yourselves, and I see that many of you are already doing so in the chat box. So if you haven't already done so, I would love for you to pull out the chat box and introduce yourselves with your name, your role, your organization, and one thing you're hoping to learn today. So if you haven't put that yet in the chat box, love to see that addition in the chat box, something you're hoping to learn. So if you've already introduced yourself, feel free to add that as an addition, something that you're coming to this presentation hoping to learn. And we'll look at the chat as we go to make sure that we're flying in formation together around our goals today. Again, really good to see so many folks here from across the state to be a part of this conversation. And I'm just going to reflect back a few things I'm seeing in the chat about what you're hoping to learn. Anything that makes data collection distribution easier. Okay, that's always a goal, right? So thanks for sharing that. Please add anything you're hoping to learn. We'll be happy to see your goals for this conversation here. Data elements will be required to be reported out. We'll talk a little bit about that for sure. If there's any standardized data fields or templates, okay, these are all really good questions. Something else I'll note throughout this presentation is that we anticipate you're going to have a lot of questions, particularly about today's conversation, and we really do encourage you to put those in the chat. We're going to capture all the questions you have in the chat at the end of this presentation and share them with DHCS There are also folks from DHCS on this presentation, so they're also going to be interested in hearing your questions. So if there are particular things you're hoping to learn that we don't talk about today, that's also really good for us to know. So keep that conversation coming in the chat. Again, welcome. Really glad that all of you are here. A big welcome to folks who are continuing to introduce themselves in the chat. So here's where we're headed today. We're currently doing our introductions and welcome. We're going to start by talking about the importance of data collection and reporting. Why is this a part of the conversation with all the trainings you've been receiving around mobile crisis implementation? Why is data collection important? How is it going to help us in the short term, but also in the long term to meet our goals? We are going to talk about data reporting requirements, something I heard a few of you in the chat specifically say you're wanting to hear about. So we are going to talk about the requirements as they appear in the BHIN. And then we're going to have a conversation together about the infrastructure that you're going to want to build for effective data collection and reporting. So we'll think together about what things you currently have, perhaps as infrastructure, and what things should you start building now as the benefit goes into effect soon, and that data collection needs to start from the moment that it goes into effect. We'll do a quick summary of all of our learnings, and then we'll have some time for Q&A. So here's our learning objectives. Here's what we're hoping all of us will come away from this presentation learning. We're going to describe the data reporting requirements as they're described in the BHIN. We're going to talk about the benefits of effective data collection and reporting, including ongoing improvement, accountability, sustainability, and resource utilization. We'll talk about potential challenges for data collection and reporting facing mobile crisis teams and hopefully some solutions to overcome those challenges. And then again, we'll talk about infrastructure needed for effective data collection and for ongoing quality improvement to use that data well and effectively. I also want to note that many of you have been attending many presentations, and so you'll note that these presentations really are building on each other. So these are really kind of a building blocks of learning across a broad curriculum. So today we're going to draw a little bit on the community partnership coordination strategies training. There are other trainings specifically about billing as well that probably overlap with this training. So just think about these learnings as building on each other across time. Also of note, documentation requirements for mobile crisis services will be coming up on November 16th, and that also overlaps with this training. And a reminder that all of the archive trainings can be found on the M-TAC website, which is hyperlinked here in the slide. So both this training will be archived there, as well as any other past trainings that may relate to this topic. Okay, so let's jump into our conversation by starting with a conversation about the importance of data collection and reporting for mobile crisis services specifically. So why is it that this is something that we want to turn our attention to at this point of preparation? So in this part of the conversation, we're going to talk about these points. We're going to talk about how effective data collection helps you to design program improvements. We're going to talk about accountability through transparency. We'll talk about sustainability, how data collection now will help with us to build sustainable programs. We'll also talk about resource utilization and maximizing our resources. We're also going to spend some time talking about staff morale and how staff morale can be impacted by the data collection work you're doing. And then also how you're doing this data collection within the context of your entire community and all of your community partners. And so how the development of community-based resources can be supported by the data collection work you do as part of mobile crisis. And I'm gonna pause here and I'm gonna look in just the chat for just a moment. I see folks have continued to contribute to the chat around what you're hoping to learn. So I wanna take a moment here and make sure that we are flying in formation together around what you're hoping to learn. I see that folks are hoping to learn something about data collection fields and forms. So that folks won't have to create additional systems to collect required information. And we're going to touch on that. So thank you, Caitlin, for bringing up that point. And any requirements around data elements that have to be required for reporting. So thanks for folks who continue to contribute there. Okay, so let's talk about this first point, which is designing program improvements. So data is important. We're going to talk about the fields that you're required to collect later. And I think that's going to make some of this really come alive. But data really helps us to understand if you're meeting your program goals and also help you understand if you have specific opportunities for quality improvement. So when we talk about all the fields that you're collecting, you're going to think about how that data is going to help you understand your large goal of trying to serve a community equitably, trying to de-escalate at the time of encounter, trying to prevent individuals from having to have emergency room visits or be elevated to another level of care if possible. Your data is going to help you understand if you're actually meeting some of those goals. It's going to help demonstrate that you are being effective and what you're saying Mobile Crisis is trying to do, or if you're not being effective in reaching some of those goals. In a prior training, and we'll talk about this throughout this training, we talked about opportunities to collaborate with your community to help your community understand that this benefit exists. Specifically, thinking about marginalized communities, individuals that have historically been hesitant to receive care or to reach out when they're in a crisis. So data regarding demographics, for example, can help you to understand if some of those community engagement efforts are actually proving effective, if folks are utilizing the benefit, or if you still have some work to do around building community trust. It's just one example. It also can help you to understand if there are certain components of your program that are actually being successful, or if there are components of your program that are lacking, if there's something that isn't working as well. So data might help you to really do some of that deep analysis. And when we think about how you're going to use this data and the staffing that you need to think about looking at your data constructively, we'll talk about that as well. So you're doing some of that analysis to try to identify where are we being effective and what program components actually may need improvement. Again, talking about community, and we'll talk about this again in just a moment, data sharing agreements with your community partners might help you to understand where your programs are proving effective. So if as part of your community collaboration and coalition work, you have data sharing agreements, or you're also looking at data from those providing services in your community, this might help you alongside your own data to understand where you're actually proving effective in doing some of these things, such as de-escalating at the time of crisis, preventing folks from having to visit an emergency department instead. And those data sharing agreements can help you to understand if you're actually being effective or if there is room for improvement. So just a reminder, this is from that community collaboration and coordination training that we did previously. I'm going to reference this throughout the training because so much of this work is done within the context of community. And in that training, we talked about how one of your first steps, and hopefully you all have already started to do that, is to build these relationships with your other crisis services within your county to understand how all of you need to be working together. And one of those things, one of those opportunities for shared coordination is exactly around this, around data. So opportunities to share data, to increase transparency with each other through sharing the data that you are collecting. This can help your community partners, and we'll talk more about that in a moment, to understand what you're up to, but also understand opportunities for collaboration and coordination. But those data sharing agreements are one of the key things that might happen in this second stage of your process of collaboration, so that both you're able to see from their data if your work is proving effective, but also they're able to see your data and understand the folks that you're providing services to through Mobile Crisis and how that might be filling some of the gaps that they're noticing in their own services. So this four-phase process that we described, including here in the fourth stage around oversight and sustainability, that reporting to each other around this data and talking about that together with your community partners is a really important way to continue strengthening those relationships for the service of your community. So keep that in the back of your mind when you're thinking about this data collection. It certainly is for certain purposes as it relates to Medi-Cal. And certainly DHCS, as we're going to talk about, is going to give you certain requests and requirements for how you submit that data. But this is also something that is part of a conversation within your own community context. So thinking about sustainability, which was actually that fourth phase, right? And so this is another reason why data collection is so important. That data regarding your outcomes and your effectiveness can be used, as we said, to bolster collaboration and your coordination with your community partners so that your program can actually be sustainable. So this is part of you helping your community to understand why mobile crisis is so important, why it actually is something that should be sustained through funding and through community support, for folks to be able to see the benefit of it, that it actually is of true service to your community, that it as a model is something that is of benefit to your community. And you being able to share that data out in a productive way is an important part of being able to get that community buy-in. And in addition, as we stated, being able to demonstrate that you're meeting your goals might also help you with ongoing funding and support, and hopefully to expand your services or replicate the services as your community understands that they are in fact being effective. So ensuring sustainability is your second point of why data collection is important. Another reason might be to enhance morale. And I think this is a really interesting point. In a prior training, we've also talked about recruiting staff for mobile crisis and retaining staff for mobile crisis, challenges that we know that some of you may face in your counties in recruiting and also in retaining. And so data collection is actually a really interesting way of thinking about what it does for your team, in addition for your community. That by you being able to say that, yes, we're meeting these positive outcomes, our mobile crisis programming is making a difference in our community. We're able to serve these demographics. We're able to have these impacts upon individuals in crisis and upon their families. This can help your folks who are doing your work to feel really good and positive about the work they're doing, even as you probably will face some challenges as that work is rolling out. It also gives you an opportunity to really celebrate strong team performance, to recognize where teams are working together well, where they're accomplishing goals. In a prior training, we talked about the variety of teams that may be made up of different types of professionals and also of peers and of community health workers. Looking at your data and looking at the construction of your teams can provide a real opportunity for folks to celebrate each other's work, to understand where these mixed team compositions really are a benefit to the community. Data can help you to name all of those things and to celebrate them as a team, which certainly can enhance morale and hopefully help with retention. So that's another reason that we want to name about why data is an important part of your work. Our next point is maximizing resource utilization. So their data that you're collecting can help you understand where your behavioral health infrastructure may need improvement within your community. And it could bolster support for particular resources in your community. And again, thinking about the context of your community collaborations, right? This is where your community partners are going to be really grateful for some of the data that you're collecting, because it could point to the need for certain services in the community. Perhaps their services are probably are underfunded as well. And so you're just gathering additional data points to help support the fact that perhaps some of their resources need to be bolstered through additional support. One of the examples that we included here is that encounter data, and we're going to talk about some of the fields in encounter data in a moment, could be utilized to demonstrate the need for additional resources or programming to serve a specific community, or maybe even a geographic area. So if you're serving a large county and you're noticing that you're having high utilization from a particular part of your community, that can help build a case for the fact that there is a need for additional resources, behavioral health resources for that part of the community. Perhaps you have a provider desert in that area of the county. So your data can help you identify if there is a geographic area that needs additional support. And it's really likely probably that a lot of you already know that, right? You know the parts of your community where there are a lack of resources, but this data really is important for you being able to back that up to say that we have data from our community, from the way that people are utilizing our mobile crisis services that help us understand that that part of the community may need additional resources. So this is really to the benefit of your entire behavioral health infrastructure when you're able to gather effective data. And this kind of leads to this next point, which is the supporting development of community-based resources. So these findings that you have around who you're supporting, who you're actually having contact with, how you're able to support them, can help your community-based behavioral health treatment programs and services perhaps be bolstered by saying that you need additional resources to help a certain type of community or to help a community in a particular area. So I'm going to go back really quickly just to say this is the last of the points of why data collection is important. So we've talked about a variety of different reasons. We've talked about the fact that it's going to help your program to understand what you're doing well, and why there might be an opportunity for improvement. We've talked about how it helps you in your community collaboration and coordination, that as you talk to your community at large, and you're looking at their data, you're able to share your data collection with them. It helps you to identify opportunities to improve your collaboration and your coordination. It's going to help you boost your staff morale as you're able to celebrate success and understand why you're being successful and how. And it's also going to help build a case for behavioral health infrastructure at large, and help you understand where in your community or whom in your community might need additional resources. And not just say that, as again, many of you probably already know that, but have the data to back that up. So those are just a few reasons of why this conversation is so important. Many of these probably that you already knew, but within the framework that we've been using to talk about your community and mobile crisis services. Okay, so now we're going to get to the part that I know many of you were saying you were eager to learn more about, which is your data reporting requirements. So I'm going to start this part of the conversation by saying that today is the beginning of a conversation around data reporting requirements. All of you know that you're required to collect and report data as part of the BHIN. We'll talk about that in a moment. You also know that that data collection is required to begin the moment that this benefit goes into effect. So I would really encourage you to use the chat vibrantly throughout this section. There also is, again, one part of this conversation where I will invite you to use the Q&A box, because we want to get some targeted feedback from you, because some of the tools that are being developed for this are still in development. And so we hope that this will be a conversation together, so we make sure we understand your questions fully, so that what is being developed actually will meet your needs. So what are the requirements? So this is just in brief, and we'll provide more details here in just a moment. The BHIN requires data collection and reporting related to these three broad outcomes, or three broad areas: demographics, process, and outcomes. How is this going to be used? Well, this will be used by DHCS to monitor and oversee the Medi-Cal Behavioral Health Delivery System's implementation of the Mobile Crisis Services benefit. So DHCS needs this data to understand what's happening and make sure that they can say that this is successfully being implemented and make changes along the way. And DHCS, as I stated, is currently developing data reporting tools and guidance. So there's going to be additional information in addition to today's conversation that will be forthcoming about the tools and the reporting requirements. So today is the start of a conversation so that we're all on the same page around what's required, and then there's going to be additional conversations in the future. So what exactly are the reporting requirements? So this is exactly what's listed in the BHIN. And so I'm going to read through this, but I'm also going to make a couple notes about some of these fields. The first thing I'll say is that as you start to think about your infrastructure you're going to need to effectively collect data, some data, of course, may be collected or need to be collected at the time of encounter or during an encounter, but there's some data that may be reported immediately after recorded directly after the encounter. So you may start thinking about what are those fields that are required and which of those actually need to be collected at the time of encounter, which perhaps could be recorded directly at the time of encounter, may include demographics. And a note about demographics, as one of you already noted in the chat, you don't want to duplicate anything in your data collection. And so it's possible that some of the demographic information that's required to be collected by the BHIN may actually be accessed elsewhere. So this is one of the areas I'm going to flag for you, where you're going to receive additional guidance related to how you capture demographics, because DHCS does understand that you don't want to duplicate anything in your data collection process. And it's likely that some of the demographics that the BHIN requires you collect information about, which includes things like age, race, ethnicity, sexual orientation and gender identity, that some of those things might be accessible in another way. So more to come regarding specifically demographics. Other things that the BHIN requires that you are collecting and reporting data on include the crisis location, response times, the disposition of the counter, if you were able to de-escalate to a community-based setting, for example, if the individual was taken to a stabilization unit, if there was a warm handoff, what happened in the encounter, the individuals who are participating in the encounter, was telehealth utilized, was transportation needed, and if so, was that transportation provided, was there law enforcement involvement, and any information about follow-up check-ins with the individual. So these are some of the other things that you'll be asked to collect data about. And I want to pause here and connect this to our prior conversation on why this is so important. So you're starting to see by some of the things you're going to be collecting, how this can really help you in the future to understand what your program is doing, where you're being successful, or where you might need to improve. Right. So the outcome, for example, which is called in the BHIN the disposition of encounter, that outcome can help you to understand how successfully you are actually collaborating with your community to do a warm handoff, for example. Are you successfully doing that on a regular basis? Are you de-escalating in the encounter? That's all important data for you to understand your response times, right? Which we know there are certain requirements around response time. So that's going to be important for you to understand. Crisis location, like we talked about earlier, understanding who in your community is needing these services the most. That's really important data for you to be collecting. And we're going to talk a little bit about technology and crisis location later on in the presentation. But hopefully, as you look at some of these requirements, it helps you to understand, certainly DHCS is going to be looking at some of these data inputs, but also this is going to help you in real time to understand opportunities for improvement. We're going to go to the next slide. Those are the data reporting requirements overall. And a word about next steps. I'm going to pause there because I'm seeing a couple questions. So I'm going to pause before I go to the next slide because we're going to have a little bit of engagement here. Suzanne asks if a warm handoff can be defined. So in brief, a warm handoff is, as defined in the BHIN, an opportunity for mobile crisis to do a point of contact from the individual in crisis directly to another provider, usually in another elevated point of care. So another setting that would be viewed as an elevated setting for care. And so why it's called a warm handoff is because that's happening directly from you all as the mobile crisis team directly to those other services. And it may in fact involve transportation. So thank you for that question, Susanna. And again, there's a training just about warm handoffs that you can watch the recording of to learn more about warm handoffs. We're getting a few questions about why certain things need to be collected, including the professional titles of team members. And so thank you for these questions too, related to, I see a question about transportation. Kristen, that's a really interesting question. As it relates to transportation, your question is if the client required transportation for a crisis or for the disposition. And so thank you for sharing that question with us. We'll provide additional clarification around exactly what types of transportation need to be recorded. I'll offer in the context of the warm handoff training, and as the BHIN states, that sometimes transportation should be provided by mobile crisis to another setting of care. And so if that transportation set was needed from the point of contact, from the encounter to another point of care, that certainly would want to be recorded. But if there are other instances, that's something that we'll certainly provide additional guidance on. So thank you for that question. Daphne also asks if we have definitions of urban and rural to determine response time requirements. And Daphne, thank you so much for that question. And again, I'm going to point several times to some of these responses, thankfully, to the fact that we've had some prior conversations on this. So there is, in fact, a training that's just about mobile crisis and rural settings. And so if you can review that recorded requirement training, you're going to find a definition of what is rural, how DHCS is defining rural, and what that means for response times, because there is a different requirement and allowance around response time for rural settings. So Daphne, I encourage you to find the recorded training around rural communities, where you're going to find more information around response times and rural communities. Okay, I'm going to move on now from this, but I'm just going to summarize where we've been, since we've been having a conversation, a vibrant conversation with the chat, which we're really grateful for. Just a reminder that these are the things per the BHIN that data will be reported on. And another reminder that additional guidance around how you're going to collect some of these things will be forthcoming from DHCS. The BHIN also requires counties to conduct member satisfaction surveys, which would be something after the point of encounter. And so we're really interested to hear from you all. DHCS has solicited some feedback about this in other settings, but this is an opportunity where I'd like to ask you to use the Q&A box rather than the meeting chat. And we're curious to have you share with us, what information do you believe should be captured in satisfaction surveys? So after the encounter, remember the last slide was all of the encounter data. So data about that encounter, the BHIN requires you to conduct satisfaction surveys after the fact. What information do you think should be captured in those? And if you have some ideas about why. In just a moment, we're going to talk about tools, but Frank asked what software are folks using to enter data. And so Frank, we're going to talk about that in just a moment. If folks are using Excel or some other sort of software, would love to hear folks' input. And Brittany notes in the chat regarding gathering data around folks who are not Medi-Cal beneficiaries. And so Brittany, thank you for elevating that question. That's a really important question. While the focus of this data collection is related to Medi-Cal beneficiaries, and there has been some training related to eligibility, for example, for this service, there will be additional information and guidance forthcoming around the data that you're gathering around folks who are utilizing your mobile crisis, but may not in fact be Medi-Cal beneficiaries. There certainly is an interest to understand how many of those folks are utilizing the service if they're not a Medi-Cal beneficiary. So please be on the lookout for additional guidance around that. That's a really excellent question. So thank you for elevating it. And Isaiah, thank you for adding your thoughts around additional demographic questions and questions around demographics, which things may be included and which things you can track within your electronic health system. So I'll repeat back something that I said earlier as it relates to demographics, that DHCS is very attentive to the fact that some demographic data you may have access to already. And so there is going to be an intentional effort to not have you replicate anything in your data collection process. So as it relates to things you may already have access to within your electronic health record system, there will be additional guidance provided. And then that can help you understand where there may be some gaps. One individual shares that you've been drafting a survey. And Shereen, I'm assuming this is talking about the satisfaction survey after the fact. So yes, we're taking all of your input here about the satisfaction survey, and DHCS is going to be interested to receive all of this data so they can offer you some guidance and suggestions around tools. So yes, we will want you to be on the lookout for additional tools. And thanks for folks who are putting your input here, both in the chat about the survey and also in the Q&A box. Michelle, thank you for your point that people in crisis are often overwhelmed by surveys. So timing is important. That's a really excellent point. So thank you so much for elevating that. That's something to be sensitive to, and we'll talk about that here in a moment. Let's talk a little bit about infrastructure, which is a lot of what your questions actually relate to. So what infrastructure do you need to build for effective data collection and reporting? So there are a couple different ways you can think about data collection approaches. And I've already heard some of you say, you know, are you using an old school approach, which is kind of a low-tech solution, a paper form? Are you using a high-tech solution? And so we want to spend just a moment and say that there could be pros and cons to both, and spend just a moment thinking about that with you. If you choose to use kind of a low-tech solution, which could include a paper form that you're using to collect data on, a spreadsheet that you're then putting that data into, you know, this could be more labor-intensive and resource-intensive upfront. because you're having to do some of that data transfer. Also thinking about in the moment, folks get busy, you're trying to record data, you have to maybe go to another encounter, you're trying to do that quickly. Sometimes some data may be compromised by folks writing too quickly. Handwriting might be hard to interpret later for someone who's having to put that into an Excel spreadsheet. For those of us that don't have great handwriting, that might actually be an issue. And again, the time required to do that manual entry later, that's something to maybe think about. With high-tech solutions, for example, many individuals will be using iPads or other tools to facilitate telehealth and other parts of mobile crisis. So a high-tech solution could include something like an iPad where you are automatically able to place some of the data in a location in the iPad, perhaps directly in a spreadsheet or another tool that automatically correlates to your larger collection mechanism. Now, the drawbacks of that are that if you're relying upon Wi-Fi service to make sure that all that data is speaking to each other, if you're in a rural county, that may be an issue, as we've discussed in prior training. So there are certainly solutions. Some of the high-tech solutions may also come with challenges, even if they are perhaps more effective for other reasons. So thank you for thinking about that as well in the chat. I see folks are thinking about some of the opportunities with low-tech and high-tech solutions. Susanna shares that that having a QR code could make it easier, but that you're still having a hard time having anyone complete the survey. So thank you for that, Susanna, to go back to that conversation around the satisfaction survey and a QR code. That's an interesting high-tech solution, example of a high-tech solution, but still having a hard time maybe getting folks to utilize the survey. So that's good feedback for us to know as well. And I see a few folks using QR codes. So it looks like a few folks are technology-minded as it relates to how you're getting folks to access surveys that you may have. So thank you for sharing that. And I also love looking again in the chat, folks are sharing links to other suggestions, right? Satisfaction measurement models, other tools. So that's also really great to see. So another thing for you all to consider as you're thinking about the infrastructure that you need to build, we just spoke about the tools that you may need, and this is high-tech and low-tech solutions, but also to think about the staffing considerations. And I've seen a few of you already talking about this in the chat, about the time required to do some of this work. So to think about the infrastructure that you're needing as you build your teams, there's certainly the time needed and the staffing needed to do data entry, right? But then also to think about analyzing that data, particularly within the context of community collaboration. If you're using that data in real time to collaborate with your community, having the staffing to actually look at all this data you're collecting, do some meaningful analysis, understand what it means and does not mean. That's a staffing consideration. And then thinking about the staffing that's going to be required to take that data that you're collecting, to organize it, and then report it effectively to DHCS. So some of your needs might become clearer as you all receive additional guidance around reporting, but you should be thinking about now that your staffing is going to need to consider all of these components of data entry alongside provision of mobile crisis services, as this is part of the requirement. The other thing to consider is training, that all of your staff are going to need training. So once we have additional guidance around what data should be collected and how that data will be reported, and once you receive that information, whether you're going to use a high-tech or a low-tech solution, you're going to need to train and orient all your staff to the systems and the technology you're using, the best practices regarding how to collect that data, how to collect it in the field if there are challenges in doing so, how to overcome some of those challenges if they relate to a lack of time, if they relate to not being able to perhaps fully get folks to respond to some of the questions. Is there patterns you're seeing there? Training regarding how to collect that data in the first place, then also how to overcome challenges that you may be facing around responses is training that you're going to want to provide to your staff. And as we talked about earlier, one of the opportunities for data collection is quality improvement. So when we think about this from an infrastructure level, this provides an opportunity for you to identify gaps, to understand where your staff might be struggling with certain parts of providing mobile crisis services, if they're having a hard time with certain parts of the encounter. Some of the data will help elevate that for you, which provides you the opportunity to think about how to be doing constant quality improvement alongside your team, mentoring and additional training as needed. We also want to take a moment to talk about special populations and say that there's probably a lot to say about special populations as it relates to data collection. And I've seen some of you elevate that in this chat, and I want to say thank you for that. There's two communities that we want to call out, particularly as it relates to data collection. One being tribal communities. And I want to say that tribal experts are working in collaboration with DHCS to assure that issues related, special considerations related to tribal communities are being considered as it relates to any requirements related to data collection, and that the forthcoming guidance related to data collection will be sensitive to the special and unique needs of tribal communities and tribal sovereignty. We also want to name that LGBTQIA plus communities may have special concerns as it relates to data collection, privacy concerns as it relates to identity issues. This may be particularly true of transgender or non-binary individuals that you're working with in your community, particularly perhaps at the intersection of certain other identities. And so that's another place where privacy concerns and best practices about assuring data privacy come into play. There'll be additional guidance as it relates to data privacy as well in future conversations. And there also is a link at the end of this conversation, the end of this chat, which is also linked at the bottom of this slide, related to best practices related to data collection and LGBTQIA plus populations, specifically around concerns around privacy and how to address some of those concerns at the point of contact. So an additional resource for you if you're specifically concerned about special populations. Daphne puts in the chat that related to privacy concerns that your largest response to gender identity is declined to answer. So thank you for sharing that, Daphne. And there could be multiple reasons for that. And certainly one of them could be a concern around privacy, specifically given the current climate. So thank you so much for sharing that with us. Going back to the chat, folks are continuing to contribute related to satisfaction surveys. And Shireen notes that some folks do a phone call follow-up to administer a satisfaction survey. So thanks for sharing that as another potential mechanism, another way of making sure that you get some of these satisfaction surveys completed after the fact and that you get responses. So would love for you to put in the chat, we've had a vibrant conversation in the chat, which is really excellent, and we're coming towards the end of our conversation, but would love for you to answer this question in the chat, as again, we're capturing this chat for future conversation. What tools or infrastructure can you leverage to meet the data collection and reporting requirements? And I'm going to reflect back some of what I'm seeing in the chat, because I'm seeing a lot of innovative ideas. So we've had folks mention phone calls, perhaps, to administer a survey. I also saw Susanna put a quick postcard style for a survey or an incentive for completing the survey. So thanks, Susanna, for mentioning that as a postcard idea. Also, I appreciate that folks were elevating, when you think about technology, that you also have to think about the folks that you're serving. And so some folks may not have access to technology, right? So if you're asking someone to complete something and it requires a use of technology, like a QR code, like some folks have suggested, to remember that some folks in crisis may in fact be experiencing homelessness and may not have access to the technology they need. So thank you for elevating that as well, Jacob. That's a really important point. So when we think about all the different ways we might try to complete this, we have to make sure we're matching it with the actual needs of our community. So thank you for that. Lots of good feedback in the chat, and would encourage you to offer your suggestions to this as well around current tools or infrastructure that you feel like you can leverage in addition to what already has been placed there. Thank you to folks who are talking about the tools you're already using. It's really good for us to see that as well and understand the breadth of what folks may be using. So we're getting towards the end of our conversation. So we want to summarize where we've been today. We've talked about a lot, I will say, of the trainings that I've done as part of these building blocks. This is the most interaction we've had in the chat. So I want to really say thank you for that. It's been a little challenging to keep up. You all have been really, really active in the chat, and that's great. And I can see you all helping each other as well by providing suggestions and interacting, which is great to see in this community of learning. So here's a summary of some of the things that we've talked about today. we've given you an orientation to the reporting requirements as they're described in the BHIN. And again, I'm going to reiterate that DHCS is currently developing data reporting tools and guidance. So to be on the lookout for additional guidance around tools and exactly what the requirements will be as it relates to some of what the BHIN states. We've talked about why effective data collection is important, that it benefits mobile crisis teams in a variety of ways, including your efforts to assure program sustainability alongside your community partners, to understand your program successes, and to understand your challenges. And we've talked about ways that you might be able to prepare now for the forthcoming data reporting requirements by considering your opportunities to leverage current infrastructure, like many of you already have great infrastructure in place that you'll be able to leverage, by considering the staff that are necessary to effectively record and report data, and the training protocols that you may need to put into place to make sure all of your staff are oriented at the same time regarding data collection, and that you're identifying where there are any challenges in the field in real time, and you're able to provide ongoing mentorship and ongoing training to make sure that you're collecting, recording high quality data, not just at the beginning of this process, but throughout with your teams. And so I'm just going to go back here to our chat to see if we have any additional questions related to this content. So as it relates to tools, Susanna shares that your data collection is a custom-built form. So it looks like some folks have things that are specifically built. Folks are naming a couple different systems that they use, which is helpful to see in the chat. Susanna also mentions that in the past, you've used an internal built web app for data collection. So that there's an opportunity to use something like that. And that's one of those high-tech solutions. So thank you for that suggestion. Okay, I'm continuing to look here in the chat. If you have any additional questions we can answer, it would be great to see those there. And it's great to see folks listing tools. So thanks for continuing to do that in response to that question. So in summary, we're gonna close out with just a couple slides, but in summary, I want to say thank you for the really vibrant conversation. And again, remind you that we are capturing all of these questions. I know that there are a few questions that we still don't quite have answers to. And so my response to you is that we're gonna collect those. We're gonna look at the questions that you've had, and we're gonna make sure we can give you some solid responses with our partners from DHCS after this training. And again, I'm just going to say thank you to all of you for being such active participants in this conversation. And I'll put in one last plug for the fact that this training did build on a lot of prior conversations, and that was really manifest in today's conversation. And so a reminder that this training, as well as all prior trainings, have been recorded, and you can also access them on the M-TAC website and watch those recordings. So I'm going to elevate a few that this training connected to, and I saw in the chat, questions related to rural settings, and there's a training related specifically to rural settings, questions related to warm handoffs, and there's a training specific to warm handoffs, and also a training about community collaborations as it relates to data collection. So all of those have been recorded and are available for you to view. Again, thank you so much for your participation. Thank you for all you share with us in the Q&A and also in the chat. This is a list of contact information for folks if you have additional questions. And also, I'm just going to share this the resources that this presentation was developed from, some of which may be of particular use as it relates to special populations or data collection in general. Again, thank you all so much for this opportunity to have a conversation with you today. Hope you have a fantastic afternoon.